This is a recording of a presentation delivered at the annual general meeting of the Institution of Certificated Mechanical and Electrotechnical Engineers of South Africa in Johannesburg. The topic is potholes and the ISO 55000, people makes the difference. As engineers, we are mostly taught how to create systems. However, most of us are tasked with managing these systems, use them to produce, and in particular, care for them. These engineers need to be developed in the areas of leadership and people management. Unfortunately, in many organizations, such development does not take place. This presentation focuses on the world of this last breed of engineers, of whom I am a member. We aim to make the world a better place by managing the assets produced by production engineers and used by plant engineers, such that they will keep on producing. This includes organizing the asset management function in the organization such that this outcome is possible. The question is, do we want this situation? In terms of roads, in terms of industrial equipment, whatever, or do we want this type of situation? What are the differences between these situations? The first difference is in terms of money. Although it's debatable that the right-hand situation costs more money than the left-hand situation over the long term. The second difference is the amount of organization that goes into organizing the maintenance function such that it is efficient. And the first difference is the will to do good and proper maintenance. I want to state that the real difference lies in people, and I hope to prove my point. As an introduction to this, let us paint the general scenario prevailing in many organizations. I personally have been in this business for very long. When I started in this business, there did not exist much of the tools that we have today. But over time, all the technical difficulties that existed in this business were addressed. Not perfect in all aspects yet, but you can do a pretty good job with what is available in terms of technology and in terms of systems and so forth. The person is the outstanding item that has not come to the table in many organizations. The bottommost people still think in terms of repair after failure only. Supervisors also do not see the point in many things that come their way. The top asset management people's biggest problem lies in the fact that they think they know. After all, they are engineers. But the fact of the matter is that many of them do not have the necessary background in failure management, as well as the brand of leadership needed in this business. And then those that allocate money for this very often do not see the need. This is often linked to company culture, which plays a tremendous role in this whole thing. This idea of this is the way we've always done it. We cannot see the reason for change. Why should we do it differently? But let us look at the seven things that must be in place to have a successful maintenance department. This picture shows that the business's assets is at the center of that which the asset management function wants to achieve. The maintenance cycle is used here to depict the definition of the strategic and tactical processes. This is the most foundational component that needs to be in place, as it drives the success of the other components. A quality maintenance plan needs to be designed. This is the main driver of the tactical process or the red cycle. And then there should be a good maintenance, operational and management system in place. This does not only consist of a computer system, but also of all the paper and procedural systems surrounding it. It is the way in which things are done in the business. The next item involves the technology that are in place to support and perform maintenance. This includes tools, equipment and instruments. Technical training is a fairly obvious requirement, but most maintenance organizations get it wrong, as they do not send artisans for retraining when new equipment is installed. This must also be a deep expertise base, in that the artisan must know how to perform the individual tasks, while the supervisor should assist him with knowledge regarding the dependence of different tasks upon one another and the coherence of the total machine. The engineer should again be able to understand the larger technical and production context within which the machine operates, and thus determine overall priorities for the maintenance action. The whole maintenance action must be supported by well-designed maintenance logistics. The analog used here is that of a racing car. Good logistics ensure fast reaction times and efficient maintenance execution. And then last but not least, all maintenance personnel must have the right aptitude for the task at hand and must have received the correct and adequate training, for instance as an artisan or as a supervisor or as a manager or as an engineer and so forth. And they must have a solid and applicable experience base. Just a note at this point in time, it should be noted that if these seven things are in place, success is not guaranteed, as other important aspects such as the work culture of the organization and the quality of management plays a big role. So what is this all about? It firstly concerns assets. Secondly, it says that systems are central to success. And thirdly, infrastructure should be in place that supports good results. However, none of this will have any positive effect without people that are enabled and roaring to go. And note at this point, we are here not talking of the people interventions practiced by human resource practitioners, although it might include some of them. No, we are talking about asset management people talking to other asset management people and winning their hearts for the matter. This triangle, which we call the strategy implementation triangle, contains a subset of the maintenance cycle, bound together by maintenance operational and information systems. It shows that the whole maintenance effort is driven from the top through the policy or strategy, using the management procedures to apply the maintenance plan to the equipment of the organization. All these elements need to be tightly bound together to achieve success. But we have a problem. More often than not, there's a gap between that which upper management conceives as the solution to poor performance of the maintenance department and that which supervision and workers seem to know is the best way, the right way to solve the problem. Very often, the lower levels do not even perceive there to be a problem, while the upper levels are desperately seeking for change for the better. The symptoms of this problem, we will look at three ways in which these symptoms show themselves. The first one, managers feel that they do not get their ideas through to the floor. Whereas the guys at the bottom, supervision and artisans, feel that management are in an ivory tower, that they are totally divorced from reality. A second way in which this shows itself is that managers want to implement new concepts, whereas supervision and artisans just want to go on, get on with the job. The third way in which it shows itself is that managers arrange meeting upon meeting to effect change, but without much result. Whereas supervision and artisans go with the flow, but they keep on doing the job as they know best, as they believe that they know best. To solve this problem, managers often try a level-by-level approach. For instance, they get someone in to do an RCM plan on the green level, or they install a new maintenance information system on the yellow level. Although these actions may be commendable, it will typically not produce the results because they just tackle a small part of the problem and they do not address that strategy gap. The thing is that the maintenance department must function as a whole, and thus the whole must be brought to a healthy state. And ISO 55000 provides a framework for implementing this. That is what ISO 55000 is about, providing a framework for implementing the required organization and the required systemization. It also provides the sorely needed standardization to an industry that tend to manage by the seat of their pants. But let us look at a short case study of a company where we were involved over the last 5 years. This depicts our methodology for assisting asset management organizations to grow. It addresses five aspects of the business. These aspects are the strategic development, the tactical development, the task focus, the management focus, and the business culture. It then drives the change process through three growth phases. It resulted in the following change in an example organization. This organization was in a very poor state when we got involved. You can see that it was performing at 31% of world class when we got involved. We, that is the organization's people plus us, succeeded in growing them from 31% of world class to 48% of the first phase, to 60% after the second phase, and to 75% in the end. Another view of this shows how the various aspects grow over time. There are six aspects, of which the bottom four are very much people related, while the top two also has important people under and overtones. While this improvement process was progressing, a master's student proved comprehensively from data gained at this organization that there's a clear relationship between maintenance input and resource consumption. By improving the maintenance situation, as we saw on the previous slides, the resource input into the production process was also reduced. And to top it all, the income of the organization grew by nearly 20% in real terms. This example case study clearly indicates the importance of people in all this asset business. What does this mean for South Africa? It firstly means that we have to invest in people development. We must put a lot in people development. Secondly, we must take hands on the road towards success. And thirdly, we must win the hearts of the people in the asset management business. This is the big issue, winning the hearts of the people. Thank you very much.